So, Amin is going to be talking about switching between relaxation hotspots and cold spots and disordered spin qubits. Amin, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. So can you see my slides and also hear me?
Yep, all
Great.
good. Thank you.
So basically, the most part of my talk is actually about from this paper here. Let me also switch to a laser pointer. But I will also talk about this paper here as well about the Balanced Weighting. So as you perhaps know, silicon is a very promising material for quantum information processing. And this is actually partially because in a bulk silicon, the spin-orbit interaction is very weak. And in addition to that, actually, there are nuclear spin-zero isotopes in silicon. So basically, these two properties make silicon very promising material. However, silicon, of course, can also have its own disadvantages. And for example, one example of them is that basically, if you consider a bulk silicon, you will see that the conduction band is actually has six-fold degeneracy. And the thing is that for qubit applications, of course, you will use some heterostructure like this. And in these systems, it can be shown that a combination of a strain as well as an interface potential actually lifts this six-fold degeneracy. And what is And basically, what we have in these silicon heterostructures is that we are left with two low-lying valley states here. And of course, for every type of qubits, the qubit can perform well only when the qubit energy is well separated from all other energy scales. In particular, for silicon spin qubits, when the spin-Zeeman splitting becomes comparable to this valley splitting here, one can show that the relaxation time becomes very short, and this condition is known as the spin valley hotspot. To review this process, let me consider this realistic case where we assume that the orbital splitting is much, much larger than both valley and Zeeman splitting. And in that case, basically, we can simply only consider these four states that contain valley states, two valley states, and two spin states. And in the absence of a spin orbit interaction, basically this picture shows the energy diagram of these four levels as a function of the magnetic field. Now, if we consider the spin orbit interaction, particularly because of the spin orbit interaction, we got a coupling between states two and three. And as a result, instead of a crossing, basically we have an anti-crossing here. And we have modified the states 2 tilde and 3 tilde. And basically, it's easy to show that in these modified states, the component that contains a spin down basically gives rise to a spin relaxation. And therefore, the valley coupling opens a decay channel. Now, as you can see from these relations here, it is actually easy to verify that the moment that the Zeeman splitting is equal to the valley splitting, this spin down component reaches to its maximum. And therefore, at this condition, the decay from this state two, for this state to, for example, the decay from this 2 tilde state to the ground state becomes maximum. And this is indeed what is known as the spin valley hotspot. And it was first experimentally observed in this paper here. Now, in order to properly analyze this process from a theoretical perspective, one needs to know a set of important quantities. And these quantities are basically the valley splitting, the spin valley coupling, as well as the dipole matrix elements. And the thing is that these three parameters do not explicitly depend on each other. However, all of them are in fact strongly influenced by a common factor. And that common factor is actually the interface roughness. And the issue with the current literature is that if you see the current literature, you will see that, as far as I know, in all of them, the spin valley coupling and the dipole matrix elements are simply treated as some free parameters that can be obtained by fitting the theory to the experiment. And this, of course, prevents us from acquiring some detailed understanding of these two important quantities. So in this work, I'm going to develop a valley-dependent envelope function theory. And you will see that basically this theory then enables us to really analyze all of these important quantities in detail. as a function of interface roughness as well as the electromagnetic field. And as a result, basically our analysis can well reproduce some experimental data for the spin relaxation time. And we can also anticipate some very interesting features. So basically the starting point is to use the effective mass theory where the full electron wave function can be written in terms of an envelope function times some other function. And basically this function captures the short wavelengths, the behavior of the electrons over the short wavelengths that is determined by the lattice constant. And the important for us at this step is to try to obtain this envelope function here. And the equation that governs over this envelope function is actually this, which is first given in this paper here. And in this equation here, HC is the confinement Hamiltonian for a quantum dot. And if we, for the moment, assume that we have some ideally flat quantum dot at zero magnetic field, this confinement Hamiltonian is basically given by this term. So for the in-plane degree of freedom, we are assuming some harmonic confinement. Whereas for out-of-plane degree of freedom, basically the confinement is determined by some out-of-plane electric field, as well as this function. And basically this function u of c captures the offset potential between these three layers. So basically in this heterostructure, the conduction band minima, for example, in silicon is different compared with silicon germanium. So in this picture here, you see the out-of-plane potential profile. And indeed, the quantum dot is here. So basically, the electron is confined here in this quantum dot. Also, in this relation here, we have this function, which is called the valley coupling. And one can show that the valley coupling actually vanishes everywhere except at the interface. So for an ideal, for an ideally flat interface at, let's say, z equals zero, this would be the form of this valley coupling. Now, what we want to do is to take into account that it can be some interface disorder. And also, in general, we have to assume that there is an in-plane magnetic field, or in general, there is a magnetic field for which, for our case, it is in-plane. So in order to model the effects of these two things, in particular, in order to model the effect of the disorder throughout this work, I'm assuming that I have a quantum dot where there are two interface steps at the interface. One of them is at the left side of the quantum dot center, and one of them is at the right side of the quantum dot center. And because of that, naturally, we have to modify this offset potential, right? And in addition, as I mentioned before, this valley coupling parameter vanishes everywhere except at the interface. So now I also define some interface function that is only present at this region here. And it is indeed very easy to mathematically model these two functions. You can take a look at this paper for more details. And then in order to take into account the effects of the in-plane magnetic field, of course, when this field is present, we have to modify the momenta and basically treat this generalized momenta here. And because of this, because of the presence of this vector potential, one can show that some extra terms appear into the confinement Hamiltonian. And at the end, basically our confinement Hamiltonian in the presence of disorders and also in the presence of an in-plane magnetic field would read like this. Okay, so now basically we have this state. Basically what we can do is to really solve this equation. It's a bit technical how to solve this equation. You can take a look at the paper for more details. I just want to mention that it is easy to show that when we have interface steps, basically the valley and orbital states are not good quantum numbers anymore. And therefore we have to introduce some new quantum index, that is valley orbit index. So for Q0, we have ground state of the valley orbital state, and Q1 is the excited state of the valley orbital state. And this is one example of the solution of this equation here. So here I assume that we have two steps like this. These are the realistic parameters that I assume. In the upper panels, you see the amplitude squared of the ground of the envelope function at the ground state and the excited state. And the lower panel, you would see the probability density at the ground state and the first excited state in the XZ plane at y equals 0. So what we see here is that because of the presence of these steps, basically the envelope function lacks a mirror symmetry. And in addition to that, the envelope function at the ground state is indeed different than the envelope function at the excited state. And what it means is that first we have both intervalued Dirkl matrix elements and intravalued Dirkl matrix elements. And this is one example of the Dirkl matrix elements that we find. So in the main panel in this plot, I'm showing the X and Z Dirkl matrix elements as a function of the position of a step, which is at the right side, where I fix the position of the other step at the left side. And you see that as basically we push this step away from the quantum dot center, basically the in-plane degrees, the in-plane Dirkl matrix elements go down, whereas the out-of-plane Dirkl matrix elements are of course nearly independent of the steps because they are given by the symmetry between the z-axis. So for details of Dirkl matrix elements, please again take a look at this paper. And also we can now calculate the value splitting as a function of the position of the step. And it is well known that the steps can significantly reduce the value splitting. And also we can calculate the Dirkl matrix elements as a function of the out-of-plane electric field and also the in-plane confinement. And indeed the in-plane confinement is equivalent to the lateral size of the quantum. So what remains is that we should also consider the spin valley coupling. And for doing so, we need to have a proper form for the spin orbit interaction. And it is actually known that the spin orbit interaction is caused by the interface. So indeed the spin orbit interaction is really localized at the interface. For a disordered quantum dot, basically these symmetrized form are appropriate for the spin orbit interaction. So you see that they are really localized at the interface. And for the Drizelhauser term, one also has to take into account the fact that the coefficient of the Drizelhauser term changes sign when one atom, one single layer atom of the step is encountered. So now we have basically these proper form for the spin orbit interaction, and having them and using our valley dependent envelope function theory, we can really calculate the spin valley coupling. For example, so in the main plot here, you see the intervalley spin valley coupling as a function of the placement of one of the steps for various directions of the magnetic field. And in the inset plot, you see the intra-valley Dirkl matrix element. And actually one can really show that the effect of the intra-valley coupling is really negligible for analyzing the qubit relaxation time. So basically there are two important highlights here. First is that because of the presence of the steps, basically this spin-valley coupling is strongly anisotropic, as you can see from this picture. And second important highlight is that at some specific directions for the field and configurations of the steps, actually the spin valley coupling really vanishes. Okay, now basically we start to really analyze qubit relaxation time. We define these strengths for the spin orbit interaction. When we introduce a fitting parameter, then we consider coupling between states 1 and 4 and 2 and 3. And then we basically calculate relaxation rate due to electron phonon interaction, Johnson noise, and 1/f noise according to these spectral noise functions. And basically this is one of our main results. So our theory can indeed nicely reproduce experimental observations with only a minimal number of fitting parameters. And one highlight here is that we could indeed show that the Johnson noise is in fact not enough to explain the low B field behavior. And of course, this theoretical analysis is obtained by assuming some particular configuration for the steps in order to see that in more detail. So here in this plot, I fix the position of one of the steps and I'm changing the position of the other step at the right side. So you see that for some specific choice, we can indeed nicely match the experimental observations, whereas for other places for the step, particularly, we got different value splitting and we also got different Dirkl matrix elements. So then we got different binds. And indeed, because of this, it's really easy to argue that the relaxation time in silicon spin qubits is actually a device dependent quantity. So one highlight here is that for this particular choice of the step position, as I showed before, the spin valley coupling goes to zero. And therefore, in this case, there is no hot spot anymore. Okay, and basically one of the main highlights of our paper is that we can actually tune the spin relaxation time by properly tuning the out-of-plane electric field. So we see that by tuning the electric field, we can tune the value splitting. And by doing that, for example, if we consider this fixed amount of magnetic field, by properly tuning the electric field, we can actually dramatically change or tune a hot spot into a cold spot, for which their relaxation time is enhanced by several orders of magnitude. But the point here is that actually one of the things that is required for quantum computation is the need to efficiently reset and initialize the qubit. And you see that actually the value splitting provides us a tool to do this initialization, because if we basically tune the qubit here, the relaxation time becomes very short, and it means that we can initialize the qubit very fast. In addition to this, we have also analyzed the anisotropic behavior of the spin relaxation time. As I mentioned before, basically we observed that the spin valley coupling is very anisotropic, and it means that at the low magnetic fields where the spin valley mixing gives the dominant relaxation channel, the anisotropic properties of T1 time follows the same properties as the spin valley coupling. And so basically, so indeed you see that this anisotropic behavior here is the same as here. Whereas at higher magnetic fields, basically the T1 time is dominated by the spin orbit mixing. And in that case, the anisotropic behavior is basically determined by the matrix elements of the momentum operator at the interface. So in our case, it's really easy to justify why we got this behavior here. So you see that indeed the anisotropic behavior here is different than the anisotropic behavior here. And I want to highlight that at these lower fields, for example, here, here, we observe that we can change the T1 time by two orders of magnitude. And this is also observed recently in experiments. With this, I would like to conclude. So we developed a value-dependent envelope function theory in the presence of interface steps. This enabled us to really accurately analyze and calculate value splitting, Dipole matrix elements, and a spin value coupling, and basically these quantities then enables us to also analyze T1 time. Our theory can nicely reproduce experimental data with only a minimum number of fitting parameters. One highlight is that by tuning the out-of-plane electric field, we can actually realize a scheme for qubits reset and initialization, and we also study various consequences of the presence of the interface steps. With these, I would like to thank you very much for watching.
Thank you so much, Emin. We have almost used all of the 20 minutes, but in the last minute, perhaps we can refer to this question by Andres. Could you please elaborate on what you mean by Johnson noise in this context?
Right, so you see that, so basically the Johnson noise is coming from thermal attrition of electrons. And for my case, of course, there is some reservoir to load and unload the quantum dot. And for the electrons inside that reservoir, there can be some dissipation. And this basically comes from that. So if you take a look at the supplementary material of this paper, it is nicely explained.
Thank you so much. I'm also curious, I don't want to take more time, but at the end of your paper as well, you're referring to this application to silica as well, potentially. Are there any other material that this can be applied to, perhaps?
Well, so yeah, so the main argument here is for us to use the value splitting as an advantage. The value splitting, I think, the value splitting is also relevant for graphene. Mm-hmm. And people are also now talking about how to basically make quantum dots in graphene. So perhaps one can also talk about that.
All right, that's great. Thank you.